And this isn't very well understood publicly. I'm a little surprised we don't talk more about it.
We're weeks away from an orbital Starship flight. SpaceX has greatly increased the size of their second Starbase in Florida. Gwynn Shotwell is openly speaking of one Starship per day and much more. Let's dive right in.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. We're on the final stretch towards an orbital Starship flight. Only weeks away, SpaceX is making the last preparations for a 33 Raptor Static Fire Orchestra. Ship 24 has survived a rigorous test parcours and Florida is getting ready for Mechazilla stacking. When will we see the orbital Starship launch? Starship updates. The SpaceX Starbase in South Texas is preparing for its biggest milestone yet, an orbital test flight of their Starship and Super Heavy next generation launch vehicle. It's a prototype, an early design of a radically new rocket concept. Fully and rapidly reusable and at the same time mass producible, not an easy task. And SpaceX does not want to leave much to chance. Rigorous testing is the key and Ship 24 is the victim. Three cryogenic tests, including thrust simulation, have been performed just in the past week. Fueling, pressurizing to max flight pressure, pressing hydraulic rams against the thrust dome, simulating the liftoff force inflicted on the thrust structure come launch day. And it seems that Ship 24 held up to the task after SpaceX fixed a header tank pressurization pipe issue inside the fairing section. Once these tests were done, SpaceX rolled Ship 24 back towards the production site and into the high bay. The next step? Analysis. After all the testing activity, SpaceX likely wants to check out the results. Are there visible problems? How did the prototype hold up in detail? And after that, it depends on the results of the checks. But if everything is fine, heat shield fixes, engine installation, and roll back to the launch site for static fires. Now you might wonder, wasn't Booster 8 inside the high bay? How did Ship 24 fit in there? Booster 8 moved inside the mega bay on June 6th and is now continuing its stacking process. The common dome section, so the part connecting both main methane and oxygen tanks, is already stacked and the second orbital booster is moving up the milestone list fairly quick. There's a reason for SpaceX's increasing speed. The final FAA decision is here. They found no significant impact of decision for the SpaceX Super Heavy launch vehicle program in Boca Chica. What does this mean for SpaceX? In the end, it means that they have a green light for their operations in Boca Chica. Mechazilla, the OLM, and the orbital tank farm are greenlit by the FAA. This means they are allowed to use them for future launches. Of course, this can be opposed in court and it's also not to be confused with a launch permit. This is given separately by the FAA. But as soon as SpaceX is ready for a launch or as soon as they can see when that will be, they now actually can ask for a launch permit out of Boca Chica and for their Starships. This is great news. SpaceX can finally proceed. Static fires next, then launch readiness. But what does this actually mean, launch readiness? Let's do a short deep dive into one of those systems that will need to perform perfectly come launch day. Ryan Hansen, whom I met at Starbase earlier this year, was busy producing some shockingly accurate renders of how the Starship orbital launch mount will work in detail. In particular, I want to talk about this. The orbital launch mount has 20 of these and they are the heart of what's going on inside the orbital launch table, so the uppermost part of the launch mount itself. If they don't work properly and at just the right timing, Starships will never reach orbit. Sometimes it's down to the little things. It can be divided into three major components: the cover plate, the hold down clamp, and the engine connector. This is what it looks like when they're moving, responsible for holding the Super Heavy booster in place and for starting up the outer ring of Raptor engines on liftoff. They might be the most complicated parts to get right. As soon as a Super Heavy booster weighing in at around 250 tons gets lowered down into the orbital launch mount, all 20 arms move into position, and once the booster comes to a rest, the hold down clamps grab the booster and the engine connectors dock with each of the 20 outer engines. This is the first critical moment. All the arms have to be at just the right height so that the booster is resting on them in a perfectly level position. All the connectors need to correctly attach to the interfaces on the engines. There cannot be a single leak. This aspect will first be tested thoroughly once Booster 7 is ready for a static fire, which should be rather soon. The second critical moment is the booster release. Once the engine connectors have done their job of spinning up 40 turbopumps of the outer ring of engines, and once ignition of all 33 Raptor engines is confirmed, the hold-down clamps will release the booster. And this is where it gets critical. First of all, the engines can char up the whole assembly if the 20 cover plates are not closed once the engines move past. This would already be bad. What's even worse though is that these arms would hit the engine bells if they are not retracted while the booster is moving past them. Musk once replied to a tweet by Starship Gazer saying that this launch mount is not easy to build. This is the kind of stuff he referred to. If you want to build something completely new, you have to try out new things to get the job done. If you want to build the largest rocket ever built and make it fully and rapidly reusable and on top, and maybe most importantly, if you want to make it mass producible, you need to come up with some great ideas to make it work. SpaceX's efforts at Kennedy Space Center are ramping up. Julia Bergeron from NASA Spaceflight was up in the air bringing us some fantastic new pictures of what's going on in my new neighborhood. SpaceX is fast. 6 out of 6 orbital launch mount pillars are up already, and if you pay close attention to the picture, you can see tracks for a large crane on site. SpaceX is in full swing on building Mechazilla 2, and it has some updates up its sleeves. This picture, originally posted by Levier154 on Twitter on April 22nd, shows one of the orbital launch mount legs, and flame diverter covers can clearly be seen on one end. These will likely be on all 6 legs. The update here is that SpaceX right now is busy attaching these kinds of flame diverter plates onto the orbital launch mount legs at Starbase. So this is an updated design. It likely wasn't even in the construction plans when they put the OLM legs at Starbase in place. At the main Starship production facility at Roberts Road, more and more columns for the Star Factory can be spotted. Stephen Marr created some impressive aerial footage. And right next to the Star Factory construction, 6 segments for the new Mechazilla can be seen as well. Lolomatico 3D and Too Legit to Quit 3D have created a nice overview for us at Y to better keep track of the progress. Segments 1 to 6 are built, segment 7 is being assembled right now. As said, all 6 legs for the orbital launch mount have been poured as well and are curing right now. This process of concrete hardening can take some time. And there is no sign of the orbital launch table yet, but I'll keep a close eye on it for you as always. SpaceX is taking a different approach with the Mechazilla 2 assembly. They know a lot more about building it compared to the first version at Starbase, Texas. It seems like they are fleshing out the different segments much more before stacking them at Pad 39A. This will speed up the construction greatly, as fleshing out the tower while it's still in segments likely is much easier compared to working at great height while it's already stacked. Do you like today's episode? Supporting us here at Y is as easy as clicking the like button, subscribing to the channel, or becoming a channel member by hitting the join button right below the video. Or head over to our Patreon by following the link in the description and become an active supporter. Or buy yourself a new shirt in the YWear store if you fancy cool space merch. Thank you so much. On June 6th, SpaceX also filed for a new construction permit at Roberts Road. Starbase 2 is getting bigger, 60,000 square meters instead of 47,500. One of the main changes is the second high bay in the new plans. Remember the slide from Elon's presentation I showed to you on the last episode? Already outdated. That's SpaceX. It showed one high bay. Sushi Fox made some renders of what it should look like now. A large footprint and two high bays. SpaceX means it. And I recently watched a new talk with Gwynne Shotwell. I do love myself a good Shotwell interview. There are not nearly enough of those out there. I'll put a link in the description for those who want to watch the full thing, but what I want to show you is this.
Can we produce a rocket that can get to orbit, like really produce? Falcon, we produce, you know, between 7 and 11 Falcon first stages per year. We're producing a second stage every week right now. But what we want to be able to do is produce a rocket a day. Producing five a year isn't going to get you there. You really want to launch hundreds on that synodic period with Mars when you're taking people there.
One per day. That's almost exactly what I calculated around half a year ago. And that's what those two star bases are supposed to achieve. Earlier in the interview, she said another very important bit.
So we need to have a production system to build rockets, much like a production system to build cars.
Building the machine that builds the machine. That's what all this is about. SpaceX knows how to build rockets. After all, they're already building the most advanced ones in the world. So their focus right now is on mass production, more than anything else. If you want to build a colony on Mars, it won't be enough to send two or three every time Earth and Mars align for a launch window. If possible, you want to send dozens or even hundreds at a time. Elon tweeted this out on June 11th. It shows Booster 7 inside the Mega Bay and with a full complement of Raptor 2 engines. They are done, all mounted and ready for static fires. And they didn't install all the Raptor 2 engines they had either. This picture was taken by high-ranked NASA representatives on June 10th inside one of the large production tents at Starbase. There's a booster engine section visible in the background, and in front you can see two new Raptor 2 engines waiting to be installed. Likely for Ship 24, it shows that SpaceX isn't scrapping together every Raptor they can get. It's unknown how many Raptor engines Hawthorne can produce right now, but this gives hope that the next booster might not take as long as the last did. And they might actually need those Raptors too. Now that the FAA has finally greenlit Starbase Texas, we're in for lots of launches this year. Today I'd like to thank Surfshark VPN for sponsoring this video. I always use VPNs when I'm on public Wi-Fi to just mask my identity, but VPNs can do so much more for you. Besides masking your identity and just making you that little harder to track, they can also help you save tons of money. Do you travel? If you do, have you ever noticed that flights, cars, and hotels seem to get more and more expensive the more you search for them online? That is due to tracking cookies and IP tracking. Even though all those price search portals you can find online always state that you will find the cheapest flights and hotels possible, they of course want to make the most money too. It's called price discrimination. Nasty word. So every time you search for the same flight, you let them know that you really want to do this trip. So what do? They ramp up the price a bit more with each search inquiry you do. Activate Surfshark and change your virtual location to wherever you're looking to travel to and unblock cheaper flights and hotel prices. Problem solved. Or did you ever notice that all those streaming services out there always have different libraries in different countries? Your friend in Sweden can watch his favorite show and you can't? Easy fix. Turn on Surfshark VPN literally with just one click and you're good to go for your movie evenings with your friends. While all this is happening in the background, Surfshark VPN doesn't track your activity either. I use Surfshark every day on my PC and my smartphone. In fact, it automatically starts up whenever I start up my PC. And they are even sweetening the deal in June. Head over to surfshark.deals/Felix and enter my promo code Felix for 83% off, plus 3 extra months for free, and throughout the whole month of June, get Surfshark's antivirus software completely for free on top. Surfshark, surf with your own set of rules. Today's team shoutout goes to Chief. Thank you for enduring the searing heat wave in Texas. Bringing us fresh pictures and videos literally every day, he's making a very important part of our show possible. If you ever see him out there at Starbase, say hi from everyone in the community. Thank you so much, Chief. We love you. Fueling, pressurizing to max... Now, you might wonder, wasn't Booster 8 in the high bay? The final FAA decision is here. They found no significant impact of significant. Let's do that again. La la la. In a perfectly level position. This aspect will first be tested through